discussion that we would like to bring is about how to publish. We have had many lectures and many discussions how to write a paper, and that's not my focus. The focus is that what's happened after the publication, after you submit your paper. I would like to have some introduction, a little bit about Sweden as a country, and from our university and myself, and then I come to the main topic that is Sweden. Sweden is a small country in terms of population, there are only 10 million, but in the European scale, the size is quite big. And in the summertime, you can see the picture here, that it looks like this. And when it's a winter time, then it looks like this. So if you come in the winter, we have a lot of snow, and then very cold. And if you come in the summer, it is a very nice temperature that you have. And also, if you are lucky, you can also see this northern light or aurora. But if you go a little bit more the north, it is also possible to see that one. In total, the country has 30 different universities, and we are one of these universities. Our university, it has 450 faculty members, and we have something about 60 full professors, and around 30,000 students in here. Then we have, it's not a so big university, so the size is middle size, not so big and not so small. But in almost all the Swedish university, they have some areas that are quite strong. And the area that we are strong and we are number one in the whole country is this key area, which is about the textile. And textile we talk about is the textile material and fashion and management and so on. The second one is the library and the information science, and for example, when you search on Google, how to find the information that you are looking for. Then it's also library, and the third one, which is our area, which is also called resource recovery, or Swedish Centre for Resource Recovery. In this center, we try to convert different types of waste and residual into value-added products. But it could be, for example, some kind of biological processes, or chemical, or thermal, or material recycling, in order to develop new products. And so we take waste and then we put it back in society. These central work into our more, I would say, engineering, and also there are some microbiology and so on. But we have also some logistic aspects, because we talk about this mobile material, and also a social aspect, which is also important that we work on the border between humanity or social science and engineering. We have a master program in the same name, which is called Resource Recovery, and it is quite popular with international students. So normally in one classroom lab, it's common to have around 10 different nationalities in this program. So they are studying, in the beginning they are always started the same, and then they choose one direction, which is more industrial technology, or polymer, or energy. When it comes to the PhD, we are the only university in Sweden that has a PhD degree in resource recovery. And the students, they learn abroad the normal aspects and the resource recovery, and they go in deep in one specific area, which could be biotechnology, polymer, energy, and so on. But in this center, we have different research groups. That my own group is biotechnology, then we have polymer, energy, resource management, sustainable built environment, and also logistics that we are working. And we have something about 50 professors and also researchers work together, and around 30 PhD students in this field. If you look at only the group of biotechnology, the first one, that is my own group, that there are several seniors, that we have at the moment six seniors. I'm a full professor, but we have also some assistant associate professor in the list. Then we have also some postdocs, that they have also PhD, and some guest visiting PhD students, they normally come from other countries, and our own PhD student, something around the world that we normally have. And as you can see here, there are also at the moment one from Indonesia, that is not faculty, but it's food and agriculture technology. But we have also many graduated here since 2010, and you can see we have several different PhDs that were graduated from our group. If I talk a little bit about myself, and that will be interesting for you. I got my bachelor in 1989 and then my master in 1991. So it means that if you go back 20 years ago, I was sitting like you there, and then somebody else was lucky. Then I did some research work on industrial research and institute, and also I did teaching at the university in 1987 to 1994. Then I moved to Sweden. This thing I did in Iran. And then I moved to Sweden in 1995, and then I got my PhD in 1999. So something around 20 years ago I got my PhD. After that, I worked with three different universities, and then 2004 I became a full professor at this University of Boras that I'm working now. And something that could be interesting I can share with you, actually I never wanted to go to university. That was I never had planned. Unless I went to university by chance. And then something which was a little bit specific for me, I was always curious about new things. And that was the main driving force. I never interested to get a bachelor degree or master degree or PhD or so on. But I was curious to learn these things, to develop new things, and that was the main driver force. And it's still from the beginning, and it is still where it is. I never wanted to publish, I never talked to you about the publication. I never had planned to publish. But I said that if I wanted to reach my goal, also publication was a minus one for me. So when I talk about the students, you can imagine how is your personality. But if you see after so many years that if you look at the moment, that we have four books that published, that I'm the editor of the books, and the fifth one is going up right now, and the 20 book chapters, and there are something more than 240 papers and journals. And I checked the scopus yesterday, and only out of the scopus, which was 232, and some patents. If you look at the citations, about 13,000 citations, if you check on Google Scholar or if you look at Scopus, it is more than 8,000. And also H index, Google Scholar 55 and Scopus 44. Something that what I'm going to tell you, most of it comes from my experience, which is an associate editor for bioprocess technology, which is one of the journals, and quite wide. It is among the top 10 journals in this year. So I think when it comes to the size, we receive something about 9,000 papers per year. So it is quite a big paper, a big journal. And also our impact factor, which is the 5.8, that's the latest that we have. So if you if you submit a paper to this journal, there's a chance that it comes to me. And then I'll take care of that. And I can make a decision if I reject your paper or accept your paper. That's keeping your mind. That's, and I have a lot of experience actually because of this role. Something that I wrote here also CITES IV. Have you heard about this CITES IV? Hello, you? I guess it's very new. But you all know about impact. Science Pond is a new one, but it is coming to the discussion, and then we hear more and more in the future. There are some aspects that I would, if I want to give the most important difference between infrastructure and the cycle score, is that the cycle score is normally looked at on the last 3 years, and infrastructure looked at on the last 5 years. And then it means that if a journal is doing, for example, if it doesn't work well, it keeps the impact factor for some time, until some years, until it starts to go down. But you will see that much faster in the cycle score, that if the journal doesn't behave well, the cycle score goes down, but the impact factor is still high. On the other hand, if the journal is behaving well, and then you see that the cycle score goes up higher, but the impact factor is still lower. So when you compare these two numbers, if you see that cycle score is higher than the impact factor, it means that the journal is still growing. And if the number is lower, it means that the journal is on the downside. That's one thing to keep in mind. Then we have also online number of editorial board and this thing for several other journals. I don't actually keep track, I don't know which one. But there are many of them. But the first question actually, is it important to publish? Those of you who are PhD students, you have to publish. Why is it that the demand for the paper to publish, I guess? But something is that, and you see that we have a force of universities to publish more and more. All the universities want to publish. And it comes from something that is called the university generations. So if a university is called a first generation university, it means that you are not just good teaching. And in Malaysia, you can see plenty of such kind of universities that they have only teaching. Basically, there is nothing else than teaching. Then it goes to planning that the university is developed, they go to a second generation university. And this second generation, it means that they are doing teaching and that they are doing research. So here you can see, for example, this Gajamaya, because of this communication and this thing, it comes to the level of the second generation university. And if you think about this, a third generation university is that they should have teaching, research, and innovation. So that's good universities in the world, they normally come into that level to become a third generation university. And they need to have innovation. And if not innovation, at least you should have research in order to stay in the second generation and not only the first one. But the point is about this publication. That, why do we need actually the publication? So of course I got a phone and then it's my voice is not so good. Publication is that when you do research, then you should tell other people that you do research. If the politician they do something, but they do stuff, they normally invite the media and then they make some kind of press release. They say that, for example, you've done good things. But when it comes to for example, the media, if you read something in the newspapers, like this Jakarta Post or this local newspaper that you have, they write something that is short news. But when you do this research work, that you normally longer, and then you want to write in a proper way. And then it comes to the, you want to say the other people that, okay, I've done a good thing. It's a very interesting thing that they have found. Then the second problem which comes in is that, okay, I did a great job, I found something interesting, but I write some kind of text about it, I could call it paper or manuscript, and then I send it somewhere to publish it, but they say that it should be reviewed. So why do you think it should be reviewed? Do you agree with this linear process or not? Again, as a good idea? What do you think? If they publish anything that you want, actually, it's become like a newspaper. It can say anything that you want, or it's even worse, that you can, for example, buy a page, for example, that announcement in a newspaper, and then you can just publish your work. But we said it's not a good idea, because we, at the university level, we create a system that we check each other. And for example, if you are doing a research or doing a thesis work or something, you have a supervisor, and then when you want to present your work, there is somebody else that will examine it. So if somebody is helping you, supervising you, and somebody else is checking your work. And so we check each other, but if everything goes well, in order to find out what is the problem actually. Or have you done everything right, or maybe you have made some kind of mistake and so on. Then, then we make a paper, and which I'm going to go through, and we submit it, okay? So what should we submit it? That's the first one. We say that you have a text of your work which you call a manuscript, and sometimes you have to have a separate figures and tables, sometimes you put it in similar to the text. A cover letter, most of the people forget about cover letter or they don't know what to write in cover letter. Then you need to have something which is called highlight, another thing which is called graphical abstract, and sometimes something we call a supplementary material. Those who are sitting here, who have submitted a paper so far? How many of you submitted a paper? Not so many, right? So then you want to submit it, then they ask you, for example, what's a highlight? And we have some authors, they don't know what is highlight. Or a graphical abstract, they don't know what is graphical abstract. And also, they don't know what to put in the cover letter. And something that you should think about, that this material are critical when you start with the paper, if they like it in the first look or they don't like it. I will come back to it later. But when you start reading, you can choose a journal that you have heard probably the journal which are called Open Access. If you go back maybe 10 years ago, you got plenty of journals that they are called Open Access Journal. So it means that when you want to publish your book, then you have to pay. If you want to pay, then they publish it and then make it freely accessible to everybody. That's the whole concept. If you don't do that, they publish it, but then you have to make, if somebody wants to read your work, they have to take your work and then buy it from the publisher. So, and you can check on the journals. For example, this journal that I told you, Bioprocess Technology, if you want to download a paper, I guess something they will tell you or something like this that you have to pay. Or if you don't pay, maybe the university is paying and you don't know that. But if I publish or if you publish in the same journal as Open Access, it means that everybody can download it freely. So now you have plenty of choices, like it's called Open Access Journal, it means that they publish everything Open Access. Or you have some normal journals with the possibility to publish open access. That is something which is well established in the journals. The second one is called open data. And then this one means that you also publish your data. And this is relatively new. Some journals, when you submit, they ask if you want to put also your data in connection to your paper, or you want to publish the data. It could be a loading car, it could be whatever that you feel that it could be good. Maybe you have done your calculation and if you could draw data, maybe somebody else can also check your calculation and do the same thing and you've done. Some people could also this, they publish their data, open data. It's more important to the fields like medicine or those health and those area. It's not so well developed in, for example, in our area or in, say, engineering or biology, and it's not so well developed yet. But I think it becomes more and more. And something which is now we have a lot of discussion and debates or also on universities, something called open research. I guess you haven't heard about it, or maybe not so much, but it will come in the future that you will hear more and more about open research. And I don't know exactly what it means at the moment, because there are a lot of discussion as to how to do that and not to do that. So principally, put all the research that you are being open and freely available. But how to manage it, how to do that, that's the detail, that's still a lot of questions. But in the meantime, something which is well established open access. It means that you have to pay money, that they publish it, and then you cover all the publisher cost, and freely make it available to everybody. So then it also at the same time make a business. For example, one of you can establish a journal, you can call it whatever you want, and then you can ask people to publish in your journal and pay you money. And especially nowadays that they publish just online, then not so much cost actually. They just put it on the website. But if you pay, for example, $100 or $1,000, it means that they make a lot of money out of that. And they've created a market for the fake journal or for non-serious journal. I just put a list of just some of them. In a couple of years ago, this is the latest information that I have, about 159 journals which were in Scopus. So Scopus are journals that they are actually fake journals or unserious journals. They may publish principal whatever you need them. Just you have to pay for it. But you can see, for example, that if you see some of the names that are here, that most of them they have something like, for example, technology and engineering and science and very general name in order to attract many people as possible. It's not so specific, most of them. But they are quite actually attractive for publication. For example, if you think about the personal hector crystallography something, then they have published over 40,000 articles, just one journal. And it is among those journals. So when you want to publish, you have to check it a bit more carefully if the journal that is your choice. It is not enough if it's, for example, in the list of this Scopus or not. Just check it and if actually it's a serious journal, if it's a quality and so on. And these numbers, the table, they say some countries that need a blacklist for themselves. But this blacklist, when the journal inside blacklist goes, some of them come inside, some of them go outside, and so on. But this is something which is important to think about. But what I wanted to tell you is that my main topic is that what happens after you submit your data. So you prepare everything, and now you click, and then submit, and then everything is clear. What we do is that the things that should be done actually is that first we will have something that's called first a screening by the editor, and then if it's a custom screening, then it goes to the review process, and then if the reviewer still everything is okay, then we get a revision that will ask you to make, for example, major revision or minor revision and so on. And then when you've done and everything that the paper is accepted, then it goes to the online first publication, and then comes the final publication. So this is the process that you are after when you submit your paper. And one critical factor is that in the speed of review, that's something that is important to think about. How quickly is the whole process that can go? If you look at any of these papers that have been published, normally in the beginning of the paper, when you search on, for example, Stiles diet or something, it's written when it's submitted, when it's accepted. Normally check the difference if thing is true. Sometimes you are not in a hurry, it can take a longer time, it's okay, but if you are in a hurry, especially if you are a student, you want to get graduated and that's important for you, then check this difference that how quickly is this journal. Some journals are quite good, some journals are not so quite good. If I give you my own personal experience, the fastest publication that I had, it was to took something around 1 month. And the slowest publication that I had, it took something between 3 to 4 years. So you can imagine that you are a PhD student and then the publication, until I got accepted, it took more than something around 2.5 or 3 years until it got accepted. So if you are a PhD student and then you are waiting for this paper to be published, you can imagine how stressful for you to be. That is quite important, yeah? And also the journals, they are competing with this point to make it fast. So the publishers, for example, they normally should take care of how quickly this online first publication or final publication comes in. And the editorial board and the editors, they should make sure that the first three steps was quickly. And it means that if the journal wants to act quickly, there is a very hard pressure on the journal, on the editors. And if I tell you one example, for example, the old journal, which is the Bioprocess Technology, they received 9,000 articles a year, something about 30 articles every day. And then each article should be processed and then be we take just 4 weeks to process the whole, so until this review process is completed, it should take 4 weeks. So it means that everything should work like a machine and like a computer, everything on time. So there is no time to, for example, like a delay or nothing. And then it creates a lot of pressure for those who are dealing with this thing. But the result is interesting, when you are submitting to the journal, then you know that was so good. But you can imagine how much work is behind that. That's the first one. Another point is that the first question is on the first screening of the editor review. You send your paper, and then you can imagine that editor-in-chief normally do this job. And in this case, we have around 30 papers of AMI, and then editor-in-chief, which is also a professor somewhere. He has a lot of other things to do. But he has to review 10-30 papers every day. And then you can imagine how much time that you can put on each paper to see if it's good to go to the review process or if it's not good. And normally, we should say that 5 minutes should be enough. So you as an author, just think, have you made your paper enough good that when somebody look at your paper in 5 minutes, can decide if it's interesting to go through the review process or if it's not interesting at all. So just give a direct reject. So if you submit it and then you receive this email that thank you for submitting this paper, but unfortunately you receive a lot of papers and then it was, so your paper was not enough interesting that we considered. So normally you will get this email. And then this email, which you usually get quickly after 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days, and it's not a good email normally. But it means that you should take blame yourself for the work, that you couldn't make it interesting for 5 minutes, yeah? Not the review process, for 5 minutes. But then when you look at it, that's okay, that's interesting work. So what then you look at it, then you normally look at only the cover letter. So what you write in cover letter and what is interesting to this one? They look at the title, abstract, highlights, and also maybe the graphical abstract. So because there is no time to read the whole article. If the journal doesn't receive so many articles, so maybe they can read the whole article before to make a decision. But if it's very long guidance value, then this portal is very important. So if is the title attractive, is the abstract attractive, the highlight, what is the highlight of this work? What is interesting? Can you say in just one word, one sentence? Now just in three words, what has been the most interesting that you've done? If you can say so, it means that you've been lucky in order to make this attraction. If not, then you are unlucky. Then you get rejection and then you have to go to another journal, which is lower. And the question that normally is constant that does it contain interesting results? What about the novelty? Is it a novelty or is it something new? Or is it, oh no, there is no novelty. I give you some of my examples. And does it have a broad audience or a very narrow audience? And then we say broad audience, it means that it can lead to many citations, and if it leads to many citations, the journal comes up. So they go on the back of the papers that they lead to many citations. It is not good only for you, it's not good for the journal that you submit. If the journal gets many citations, and also you get many citations, your citation goes up, and also the journal citation goes up, and the impact factor of the journal goes up. So, can you look at it? Is it interesting? Are many people to look at it or not? Let me give you a small example, and I checked the number based on scopes. Yeah? I just took a few keywords. I take one keyword as an example that I could use you. Okay? Let's see how many papers have been published on the different. There are about 10,000 articles published, which they have this keyword in the treatment. So, if you have 10,000 papers published, so if you publish something in this area and it is published, then there is a good chance that other people look at your paper and then you get some citations. Is it clear? So let's look at some other examples. If you look at mycotoxin, okay, how many? That the level is not so bad, but it is something on 1,000. The other one was 10,000, this one is 1,000. So it means that if you publish something on mycotoxin, automatically you should think that you should expect a lower number of citations compared to the free treatment. Yeah? If I give you another example, and this one is also have the same development, something I started in 1965, up to now it's just growing almost every year. I'll give you another one, a CRISPR. You know what it is? You know? It is the way that a new method that is how to cut the genes. And I think one of this, the latest, Nobel Prize in, I think last year or 2 years ago, it was connected to this area. And then if you look at it, until 2010, there was no publication, nothing. And then since the last 2 years, it's increasing. So something around 4,000. So rapidly it's increased. Especially the topics that are connected to the Nobel Prize, they have this type of properties. So when it's, if you look at, for example, this year's Nobel Prize, the next year you see that a lot of papers, publication coming to that area. I give you some local example, yeah? Because these are literally more international. I give you local example. I just tell you, because I'm not good, and I need to be honest. So how many papers you can see here? So and I took the numbers from 1928, yeah? And the highest number is something 39. Just the 30 paper is published and the highest number on paper. So if you publish something on paper, maybe there is not a good chance for other people, because there are not so many people that are working on paper. This could be good, could be bad, yeah? But this is the topic. But if I look at all those people who are publishing on paper, yeah? Who are they that publish? And I look at the university. And here they are university. I look at from 1928 and 2018. So the last 90 years, which university they have published on Temple, and I look like internationally. You see, global agricultural university, University of Malaysia, University about Sound, Malaysia, Rajamani University, and then here comes back to anything, maybe because of some information that we have there on us in terms of publication. So it means that, what it means? It means that if you publish on papers, then people in Indonesia, they look at it, it doesn't go beyond Indonesia. So you don't get international citation maybe. You can get citation in Indonesia. So if you want to have a higher, if you send a paper on Temple to the editors, they know these things. They look at this Temple international interesting, not so many. They can direct it. I mean, you've done a very good job and then you you found very interesting things. But if you want to publish in such a journal, they don't accept it and they don't put it in the review process because they see it's too narrow. Yeah? And that's actually the most important problem, I think, is your papers in general. I've seen many other papers from Indonesia. It is too narrow. Then you understand something in Jakarta. For you, it is important that we studied, for example, the variety of the fruits in the country market. I know that the market on that. Okay, how many people are interested in this country market? The number is actually is low, and then you will have this difficulty to get it. Or maybe identification of bacteria, translema. Can you give an international effect? So can you have some kind of bacteria or something that could be interesting for somebody who is sitting in Sweden or sitting in, for example, in Europe or US or Japan or China? Is the topic interesting for them? If the answer is yes, then you get a higher citation. If no, then you get no citation. Even if you take, for example, you take it nationally, for example, your work assumption, that would be the same, yeah? I haven't checked the assumption, but I guess it would be lower than that, because it's less known. Another problem that it's normally we see in many papers, not only from you, to say that from most of the developing countries, including Indonesia, we have a lack of a system for mentorship. That is something that it means that you need to have among those who are the authors of the paper, there should be somebody who has a good experience and should be a tough and should be criticized or what. So if you have such a kind of person in your work, then you have a better chance. Because it is better that your work is criticized by your friend, by your colleague, or by supervisor, compared that it is criticized by a reviewer or it is criticized by, for example, an editor. This is something which is important. And another problem that is getting more and more attention and important is plagiarism. Have you had any problem with plagiarism? You haven't published so many, so I guess you haven't seen these things. Does it come to the academic university as an important factor, no? Plagiarism, no? Yeah? And I can tell you what was done. Let me stop with the paper. There are something that it is called in what percent of material? So if you have the you have to check the material which you have copy paste it. I think it's from somewhere else. Okay. Okay, but do you hear me? I try to talk with them lower, yeah? What percentage of your material you copy-paste from other sources? And I would say that if you find a paper that this copy-paste is zero, I don't see any paper. But the question that what percentage? If it's we talk about maybe 5, 10, maybe up to 20%, it's normally okay. But when you go higher, then you will have a problem. what the journals do, like we have something that is called a cross check. We check the papers before it goes to the review. If it's not rejected by the first look, it goes to review. Before it goes to review, it goes to the cross check. And the cross check, we check it. Is it does it contain a lot of plagiarism or not? And the one which is the normal, you can also check it yourself if your university make a contract with the new one. It's just called identity. I don't know if it's a company or something, but you can check yourself. I give you more examples. I had many examples. I tried to remove the name and everything, and I just showed this one. Just one paper that had been submitted, and when I checked it, it had 37% plagiarism.
I think it works better.
So we got 37 projects that plagiarized from where? You see that, for example, this paper, 9% similarity. This another paper, 7%, and this paper, 2%. Just one example. And then we check, okay, where is this similarity? And this is one example, for example, that I took one part of that paper. That you see here. This one. You see, for example, this part was totally taken from one article, and this one is taken from another article. They just changed some of the words. But it changed, it just found as a plagiarist. And when it's so, when you come into that level, then you have no excuse. That's for reject. But the question actually is that where do you say that it's you are less careful, then you are more careful? In your paper, you have something called introduction or background or something. Then you have material methods. Then you have result and discussion, and normally have conclusion at the end. The most sensitive one is the material and method, is the result and discussion and introduction. If you have plagiarism in that form, it definitely goes to the reject. If you have material methods, people are different. Some people take it more seriously, some people take it less seriously. So for example, if comes to me, and if it's a similarity of method and method, we send it to a reviewer, but when it goes to a review process, if it's not rejected, then we tell them, okay, try to rephrase those material methods in order to remove this plagiarism. But some people give direct reject also because of that problem. So be careful using this type of material. Then it goes to the review process. So everything is now passed, and now we are in the review process. Then we have the... each journal has its own reviewer database. And if you look at the journal, I checked how many we have. We have something about active review or something, 5,000 people that they review for this journal. And then they review that, we give them 3 weeks. And then we wait. Normally it should be minimum 2%, normally 2 or 3, or sometimes even 4% that we send for review. And then we get what they send back, it is what is their decision, what they recommend, and then what is their comments. And then the typical recommendation is like this. I just took one of the recent papers that we had. One of the guys, reviewer number one, we call it major revision, we recommend. Number two is the reject, number three is minor revision. So, we get 3 different recommendations, sometimes even worse. One of them say direct accept, another one say reject. So if just then it's difficult for the reviewer. If all of them say the same thing, then it's simpler. But if it's different, like this, so should I give the recommendation major or minor or reject? Then when we look at both the reviewer and also we look at the comments and sometimes read also the article as an editor. And how is the reviewer? And I just put 2 examples here, just 2 of the reviewers, just remove the name. But this guy,
he reviewed, and those papers that he reviewed, he accepted his recommended accept for 13, major revision for 2, minor for 9, and 0 for reject. And if you look at on the other drive, he said accept is 0, major is 12, minor is 9, and 66 is so this is just to a typical way. One of them is a nice guy that say accept everything, and or just a very minor comment. And the other one is the tough guy. That and we have even some review where just say reject, only reject. So when we start looking and then when we get the comments, actually we look at the profile and then we say that. Is it a guy that always say reject? So we become less say sensitive with reject, right? We always reject, huh? But if it's a guy who always accept and is a nice guy or minor reject, so we are a little more careful. We should think a little bit more seriously actually about this one. So we try to normalize it and then we make our decision that for example this one it went as a my decision. My decision for this one was a major reject. So now we send it back to the reviewer, to the authors, and then they are happy that it was rejected, but they have some work to do, and then they get some comments. And then sometimes you get plenty of comments, and then you should think, is it a correct decision that I get? For example, if the comment is good, or maybe biased comment, this guy didn't like me, or maybe a stupid comment, right? That's hard. He didn't understand anything of his work. It happens, yeah? So how the question is, how you respond actually? And we have all these three categories. Some of the, most of the comments are in the first category, some critical comments and also some serious scientific comments, most of them. But sometimes when you have, for example, somebody maybe didn't like because they see your name. Right? You don't see their name, but they see your name. Is there that any biased comments? One of the papers that I wanted to publish, that which I submitted, and then one of the comments that I read it, because this author, who's not a master of this thing, he doesn't understand anything. So you can imagine, when I got this comment, how should I respond? He didn't want me to publish his work. And unfortunately, I could see her name because it was in the right place, the wrong place. I could see it was a lady, but I knew her. He didn't want me to publish his work. But how should be my reaction? And sometimes you see, you feel like a stupid comment. I made it in this way, but maybe he didn't understand anything about his work. I think it's most of them work or none of them work. But something which is extremely important, and that's some mistake that some people have. Extremely, extremely important. You should always be polite. You should always think it's different. If they give the stupid comment, you shouldn't say that they are stupid. You should feel that you need to fight in a good way, that they understand your text. Yeah? So they didn't understand your text, so it resulted in a stupid comment. And you should also think that they do this work freely, so they don't get paid nothing. So, and they are normally some expert in this field. They have a lot of publication in this field before, and they are expert in this field. So some experts, somewhere in the world, completely unknown, that they review your work, and then make this comment. If you say that, I would say more than 90% of our comments are in the first category, good comments, and then some scientific comments, and good critical comments. But some of them also can happen. If you come into the second and third category, just try to respond in very gently, not to take a hard word that he didn't understand anything of my work, or he was not in this field. Something you don't take this one. Because it affects your work. He is not the one who lose. You will become the loser. Should you respond individually or collectively? That's another point. That sometimes, for example, you receive a lot of comments, and then you do some changes in the article, and then you will see, for example, the review, the author, they respond to the comment, okay? Thank you for the comments, you've done all the things. But you don't say, what you have done? And that also would be quite hard for the editor and also to select your reader, have you done this thing or not? It's always important to respond to individually. Say, for example, if they say something, you can say, okay, you've done it, and also refer to the text in the manuscript. For example, if there's a question, for example, this methodology that you have used, for example, for this kinetic analysis or something, it is wrong. So how do you, you should respond, say that it wasn't right, but also at the same time change something in the text, but if somebody else, like a review article, don't make the same mistake. But they have, okay, we should do it in this way, and that's why you have done it. So, so because similar question can come up to any other person who will read it. So this is what you will do. And then after submitting, then the question like who will read your comments and also make a recommendation for. Normally it's reject or accept, sometimes goes for further revision. Some journals, I would say good journals, its editor normally does it, but other journals which do not have the the editor hesitates, send it to the reviewer. So some journals they have the strategy to always send the reviewer, and that's a difficult part. So and if you want to see if it's the case or not, you look at on the date of revised revision received and later acceptance. If it's short, if it's just maybe 3 days, then it means that the editor has made the work. If it's by the reviewer, it's normally the first one. Because they have to send it again to the reviewer and then they have to read it again. And sometimes it happens that, for example, one of the reviewers doesn't like your work, and that's why you have a problem. Because the editor cannot make a decision and then they send it, and then if he or she doesn't like it, then it will be very difficult to pass through those reviewers. So think about it, this also one point in the paper. So when you want to submit it, think also about that one extra point. Who will review the revision after that? If it's editor, it's normally a good case because they are experienced and they know how to do that. And normally it goes through without any particular problem. And if it's the reviewer, you can have a problem after even it's revised. So then I would like to comment on some few points that I've seen in your papers that I read it in through the years and also from Indonesia. You have the first problem that I see here that you have two accurate numbers. That's a similar trend. All of your paper that I've seen. You write, for example, 31.5734%. And if I ask you how you measure this accuracy, and you follow, we see actually is it really between 20% and 40%. That's something that they can say. Not even, for example, 31 plus minus 1. But reporting that way, and that's, if you are reporting it this way, it reduces the credibility of your work. Think about the measurement of your equipment, how accurate you can measure, and then how you report your precision. The sign of degree of temperature, always is a problem that you write the wrong symbols, and that's because temperature is the normal area that have all the papers. But that's also, there's a specific symbol for that. Don't use, for example, you take O or something, or zero, or that's crazy. Language revision, that's in many cases that your papers need a language revision. So just think that somebody among the authors or somebody that you can hire from the outside should do the language revision. And that's important, especially for the review process. Some of the reviewers, they react strongly to the language. So So even if the content is still okay, but the language is bad, then they recommend against the publication. Just think. So if you want to increase your chance, then try to have a good language revision. Sometimes, in many cases, you have not clear introduction. And that's, I would say, one of the major criticisms that I've seen from your papers. Normally, you should start from the very general to very specific. To say in that area that you're writing, and ending with a paragraph about what is your aim and goal in this work. And then you should think that, what is your novelty in this work? If you remove this, the last paragraph in the introduction, which talks about the aim, you should give it to somebody that which is not your colleagues, and then say, when they read it, they should have this feeling that if somebody does like this, then that will be a good idea. Without having it. I repeat it again, a good introduction. You say, for example, let's say like this, that you have to work on this ethanol production by chemical, for example, yeah? Then you should start in very general things, like for example, what is chemical, what is ethanol, and then how good or bad it is. And then you will have a literature review, and who has done what on this topic. And then when it's ended, in last part, before the last paragraph, if somebody read that part, it should come into mind if, with your topic, that if somebody has studied ethanol production, but then that will be interesting to do that. If you can create it in this way, it means that you have a good introduction. Otherwise, it's not. And that's a major criticism that you have in your papers. Another one that is also quite critical, how to start the results. I've seen many papers. You have the results, and then you say, for example, result and discussion, and then let's say it's section number 3, and then 3.1. It goes okay. You start figure, for example, 3.1, it shows the FTIR of these things. So, a good result is that if somebody doesn't read the rest of the paper and go directly to the result, they should understand what you've done, what you are going, what is your goal. So never start in this way that you go, for example, one figure or one table or something directly with what you got. Say what you wanted to do, what was your goal, what was your objective, and then you did all the same, make a summary, and then start to go to the detail. And that's a good similarity that we have is if you look at the newspapers, make any of the newspapers that you have. A good journalist, they do like this. You have a title, and then you have the first paragraph in all the articles. Then second paragraph, third paragraph, fourth, fifth, and so on. And then they give it to the editor of this specific newspaper, and then they look at it, and then they put they find a place for that, and then they cut it. They don't think about it, they cut it. They say, for example, if there is a place for 10 paragraph, they put 10 paragraph, if there is a place for 2 paragraph, they cut it from the 3rd paragraph. So what it means is that when the first paragraph, you say, basically, whatever you wanted to say. The second paragraph, it goes to a little bit more detail. The 3rd paragraph is more about the detail. And this is the way that you should write your results and discussion. The starting of the research discussion should say principally whatever you wanted to say. And the rest of it is just a detail. If it is interesting, then you can read the rest. Otherwise, freedom. Another one is that what is the main message of your work? What you are going to say? And that should be reflected in your figures, in your text, in your results, in your abstract, in your conclusion, and so on. And you should be able to say your work in just one sentence, only one. I have fighting in my PhD student, okay, they bring a lot of figures, and this is what we've done, and this is the result. Okay, I said, give me one message, what is the most important thing? And if you write the most important, just one message, then we can write a good paper. Otherwise, it would be very difficult. Only one. The rest time I would call it as a feeder. You need to give the volume. But just one thing is the most important. What is the most important thing you can choose? And finally, it is this statistical analysis that the problem that most of your broadcasts so that you don't consider statistical analysis, and then when the results you are presenting, it is not actually true. It could be significant differences, or maybe not, or maybe yes. But there is no analysis to say that it is so, or it is not so. That was also the last thing. I could talk forever, but I prefer to stop it and open up for questions and comments. Thank you.